The same origin policy is one of the most important aspects of web security. And there already exists many tutorials, articles, and examples about what the same origin policy is. But this is the Live Overflow channel, and I thought it would be interesting to look back at the origin. When was the concept introduced and why? I believe understanding this backstory can really help you to understand modern web security. So let's boot Windows 95. Ach, wasn't it awesome when you could hit cancel on a password prompt and still access the computer? Amazing. Anyway, in the early 90s, the internet was very basic and easy to understand. There were basically two components, a web server and the browser. On your local computer, you would install a browser, and given a URL, a location, the browser will send an HTTP request to the server requesting this resource. And then the server somewhere on the internet responds with text. But not just any text. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. And this hypertext can be, for example, an HTML document, which is basically a text file, but it has this HTML code. And the browser is a program that interprets this HTML code and renders a nice website interface for you. But the real power came from being able to link these resources together with anchor tags. You can have links to other documents and other websites. Clicking on such a link made your browser change the location. Information was now truly interconnected and easy to browse. But that was just the beginning. Around 1994-95, Amazon appeared on the internet. This was the time when more and more real services appeared. Online banking, online jobs, webmail. The technology was advancing fast. On the browser client side, HTML gained more features. For example, forms. People could enter text into forms and submit the content to the server. And of course, server software advanced as well. And engineers had to come up with solutions to problems. For example, how can you store items in a shopping cart on the computer of a customer? So for example, in June 1994, developers of the Netscape browser invented cookies. Of course, cookies had to be invented sometime. Here's how cookies were described. As you browse the web, any cookies which servers might send to your copy of Netscape are stored in your computer's memory. When you quit out of Netscape, any cookies that haven't expired are written to a cookie file so they can be reloaded next time you run Netscape. And Netscape Navigator does not send any cookies to any web server they are not for. Here, for example, I have an old version of Netscape and I created a simple login page with cookies. And as you can see, it works. We can log in as an admin. Amazing technology. Okay. I hope I haven't lost you so far, because now it gets interesting. Here are the release notes of the first beta version of Netscape 2.0. LiveScript is currently implemented only on Windows. Other platforms will be supported in beta too. Unfortunately, the link to this LiveScript documentation seems lost, but shortly after looking at the release page of beta version 2, we can read the following. Built in JavaScript. LiveScript was now called JavaScript. Netscape Navigator now includes a built-in scripting language called JavaScript. JavaScript is developed based on the Java language, which extends and enhances the capability of HTML documents. JavaScript supports most of Java's expression syntax and basic control flow constructs, but without Java's strong type checking and static typing. JavaScript is embedded in HTML documents with a script tag, and there is no compilation needed to run the script. JavaScript documentation is now available. And here's the documentation with a nice table comparing JavaScript and Java. As we know today, this changed everything. The web now has event handlers, can react on clicks and on mouse overs. You can define objects or work with time and dates. You can access forms and text inputs from the user, all in the browser directly. JavaScript made websites dynamic. So here I'm using Netscape 2.0, released in September 1995, with the first support of JavaScript. Now, websites back then made heavy use of frames. They are the predecessor of today's iframes. And in the JavaScript docs, you can see, for example, the HTML code for a frame set with two columns. And each frame references a different URL. This is how you can implement a navigation bar and the content of a page. Here, for example, the Elvis Presley site from back then. As you can see, frames are really integrated in the browser. Look how the frames are really part of the window interface. And you can resize them as well. And of course, look at the documentation. JavaScript can also interact with frames. So let me show you some code here. Here's a frame set with two different websites. As you can see, they are different domains. One domain is the login page I showed you briefly, and the other frame is the attacker page. Let me load this URL now in Netscape and have a look at that. These are two different websites, but the attacker website knows the username, password, and session cookie from the login site. If we look at the attacker website, we can find the responsible JavaScript. After a brief timeout to give the other side enough time to load, we call steal password. And steal password simply follows the frame hierarchy. It goes to the top frame, then accesses frame 2. The window object goes to the document. From there, it gets the first form of the document and extracts the username and password value from the text input element. And of course, it can also access document.cookie. The resulting text is then placed into the text area debug output here. Theoretically, we could send this information now to the attacker. Wow. From today's perspective, this is absolutely insane. Just visit a malicious website and using frames, it could load, for example, your banking website and steal your cookies, passwords, or even perform transactions. But to defend these developers a bit, this is an absolutely novel attack vector. Keep in mind, at this time, something like cross-site scripting didn't exist yet. They just invented JavaScript. Hackers just started to realize the power of JavaScript, but also it didn't take them long to realize the issue. Only a few months later, they released Netscape 2.02 with a fix. Let me just install the updated version to show you. By the way, how old are you all? Did you ever install software on Windows 95 yourself? Is this a throwback for you? Or do you see this for the first time? Let me know in the comments. Anyway, here is Netscape 2.02. And so let's open the attack website again, but we get an error. Forms cannot be indexed as an array. This error means we cannot access the forms of the other website anymore. Even removing this error line and trying to access the cookie of the other site, it fails. Let's have a brief look at the release notes of the security updates in 2.02 relating to JavaScript. Due to an implementation problem in Netscape Navigator 2.0, a privacy concern existed because it was possible for a server script to access the listing of local file names and directories on the user's machine. Navigator 2.02 fixes this problem by refusing to allow scripts from a server to view file names and directory listings from the local user's machine. Oh, okay, so this makes sense. A browser can also browse the local file system. What a cool feature. So instead of framing another website, we could also frame a local folder. Here, the C drive. And look at the JavaScript I wrote here. We can simply access all links on the page and extract it. I guess this is exactly what they realized is an issue. This might have been the first ever JavaScript-related vulnerability. This is history. So the sentence now makes sense. It was possible for a server script to access the listing of local file names and directories on the user's machine. So as you can see, the problem of accessing data from other websites isn't explicitly mentioned here. The concern was access to local files and folder names. And they are not clear how they fixed this, because you can still list all files. So somehow they made it so the other script cannot access the frames with the file names anymore. But how they addressed it, it becomes clear in the release notes of Netscape 3. Navigator version 2.02 and later automatically prevents scripts on one server from accessing properties of documents on a different server. So here, Netscape just invented the same origin policy. JavaScript running on one origin or server cannot access the data of another server. All these client-side vulnerabilities like cross-site request forgery, XSS, click checking, all that stuff is related to the core security principle of the same origin policy. However, at the time in 1995, it wasn't obvious that this would be such a big deal. Because this was the time where hackers had much more powerful vulnerabilities at hand. Look at this, even my test script is causing Netscape to crash with a seg fault. And when I load the framed site first and then open the attack site directly, it still somehow can access the data of the other frame, even though it's not there anymore. And refreshing the page, we crash again. Probably a use after free issue or something. And Java applets were also a thing, which allowed direct arbitrary code execution when visiting a website. Here's a bug track mail from 1996, yet another Java security bug. There's another serious security bug in the class loading code for all currently available Java browsers, Netscape up to and including version 2.02. Using this bug, an attacker can bypass all of Java's security restrictions. This includes executing native code on the client with the same permissions as the user of the browser. No preconditions are necessary other than viewing the attacker's webpage, and the process can be made completely invisible to the victim. As you can see, this lame attack of listing some local files or even accessing the session of another site, it was taken seriously and they agreed this is a security or privacy issue and fixed it. But the world was fighting with a lot worse stuff at the time. But still, all the work done around this time would influence web security up until today. Alright, let's shut down 95 until next time. I hope you found this interesting, because in a future video we are going to explore how all of this evolved into what we know today as cross-site scripting attacks. So make sure to subscribe if you want to learn more about it. And of course, thanks to my Patreons and YouTube members for supporting these kind of videos. It takes a lot of time to research and dig into these topics. You know, I'm not just presenting an article or Wikipedia page. I spend a lot of time reading mailing lists and web archives and trying to connect the dots. So thanks for your support. And huge shout out to the Web Archive. If you don't want to support me on Patreon or YouTube membership, no worries, but please consider donating to the Web Archive. To me, it's so incredible how much internet history was preserved thanks to them. We need to make sure this resource exists long into the future. And it's now safe to turn off your computer.